Góðan daginn og velkomin. Good day to you and welcome. I am Dr. Gunni, the author of several books about Icelandic pop music, including Blue-Eyed Pop, which is the only book available in English on the subject. I want to tell you a bit about Iceland's music history, and I will be focusing on the exportation of Icelandic music. When you look at the map and consider that only about 360,000 people live in Iceland today, and much less before, it is easy to understand why Icelandic musicians have always wanted to be able to play and make a living or even make it become famous abroad. The music scene in Iceland is simply too small, too few customers to your sounds. Musicians are very quick to get all the exposure they will ever get locally, and it will quickly get tiring to play for the same small amount of the same people. Every ambitious group and artist have therefore wanted to expand their possibilities, to take their art to more people. It has been said that Iceland only got modernized after the Second World War. Before the war, the nation was quite poor and life was about working, either fishing or farming. Musical entertainment during the first decades of last century was provided by some guy playing the accordion. The Icelandic radio started in 1930, but mostly played classical music for the first years. Also in 1930, a glamorous Art Deco hotel opened in Reykjavík called Hotel Borg, and there one could attend dances with imported big bands from England, who played modern jazz and swing. Oftentimes, Icelandic musicians got to sit in with those English bands. In 1936, the Icelandic Musicians Association, FEH, signed an agreement with the radio station to form a dance group, which would play pop music on the radio on a bi-weekly basis. The leader of the band was Bjarni Böðvarsson, usually called Bjarni Bö, so soon everybody started calling this band the dance group of Bjarni Bö. On the 10th of May 1940, Iceland was occupied by the British troops. One year later, the American army took over protecting us from the bad Germans. Suddenly, the country was full of young foreign men who had been raised on pop and jazz music. The occupation, of course, had much influence on every aspect of life in Iceland. All of a sudden, there was plenty of work for everybody. Plenty of money flooded the country, and everything basically went crazy in the small, sleepy country. The occupation also meant that more American influences were to be found in Iceland. More American movies were shown in the cinemas. More American records were available in the shops, and it became easier for Icelanders to travel to America. At this time, young Icelandic people started to go to schools in America. Those two men on the picture, Kristján Kristjánsson and Svavar Gests, went to New York in 1946 to study at the Juilliard Music School. When they returned to Iceland 14 months later, they formed the Cow-Cow Sextet, which soon became the main dance band in Iceland. They were more professional than everybody had been before, as they had witnessed in New York how real bands worked. For all of the 50s, the Cow-Cow Sextet was the main band in Iceland. It had many singers during the years, including the singer Ragnar Bjarnason, or Raggi Bjarna, as everybody called him. He was the son of dance band leader Bjarni Bö and had started to perform as a teenager. Raggi was a true legend in Iceland. His career spanned seven decades, and when he passed away earlier this year, he was fondly remembered by the nation. Icelandic pop songs on pop records started to come out after 1950. One of the first Icelandic pop stars was a gentleman crooner, Haukur Mortens. He wrote some songs, but mostly sang tunes by others. He tried his best to expand his possibilities and appeared on stages both in the Soviet Union and Denmark, where he was quite popular. He also recorded some of his songs in English and released them abroad. For the first decades, the Icelandic music scene was heavily influenced by international music. Rock and roll and then Beatlemania hit Iceland hard, and local bands played covers of their idol songs for like-minded young people. The main local Beatle band was called Hljómar, the Tjörns, and like their idols from Liverpool, they soon started to write their own music. In this sense, Hljómar was the first modern rock group in Iceland. During 1965 and 1966, Hljómar tried a lot to get their music heard abroad. For the international market, they called themselves Torshammer and played really hard and heavy rhythm and blues influenced music. Nothing came out of this at the time, but today their music is highly regarded amongst 60s rivalists, and their original records sell for huge amounts of money. Returning home, Hljómar settled for more easy listening Beatle pop and soon became the most popular band in Iceland. They released two popular LP records in 1967 and 68. But the dream of world domination was never far from them. In 68, the band tried to break into the Scandinavian market. In a joint effort with Guðlaugur Bergmann, who ran Reykjavík's hippest fashion store, Karnabær, the band went to Sweden as ambassadors of Icelandic pop and fashion. The band tends to bring together the traditional Icelandic way and the world of pop, wrote newspaper Morgunblaðið, adding, Hljómar will all be donning sheepskin vests, knitted sock shoes, caps, etc. will be brought along. Hljómar have arranged ancient Icelandic rhyme motifs and added into their music, and the ancient instrument langspil will be brought along. With the arrival of Hljómar and other bands that came after them, the modern pop rock band was a fact in Iceland. The bands reflected trends and styles from abroad. Foreign bands visiting Iceland had also a huge influence on the local musicians. When the Kinks played in Reykjavík in 65, it was a wake-up call for many local bands. The same can be said about Led Zeppelin, who played in Reykjavík in 1970. Reykjavík had its fair share of hippies playing rock and roll, bands like Trúbrot, Óðmenn, Mánar and Náttúra. The market for heavy hippie music, though, was very limited. Most people, when getting drunk and going to clubs, did not want to listen to 20-minute guitar solos. They were more into singing along to O-V, Chirpy Chirpy Cheep Cheep. In the 70s, more Icelandic bands tried seriously to get their music heard in a bigger context. The bubblegum glimmer band Chains moved to London, where they tried to make it for 2 years. Nothing came out of this, even though they appeared in a TV show with Scottish pop stars the Bay City Rollers and were dressed in corny outfits by the same tailor as Gary Glitter employed. Another Icelandic rock band that seriously tried to make it abroad was Pelikan. They played hard rock and recorded 2 albums in a studio in Massachusetts. They got to play some gigs on the East Coast and even almost had a record deal. Before anything could happen, the band had broken up. Some signs of original approach to the art of rock and roll could be spotted in Iceland in the 70s. There was Megas, a poet and a singer-songwriter, the Icelandic Bob Dylan, some might say. Megas released his first album in 1972 and has continued to release cool original records. When punk and new wave happened in Iceland, Megas was sometimes called the grandfather of Icelandic punk. Á bleikum náttkjólum, in a pink nightgown, is usually considered the best Megas album. It was a collaboration with a folky rock band called Spilverk Þjóðana, English translation, Gamut of the Nations. Spilverk Þjóðana released some interesting albums in the 70s and almost had a record deal with a foreign record label. Nothing came out of this, as the foreign label wanted Spilverk to transform into the Icelandic version of ABBA. This was of course something that the serious artists in Spilverk never even considered. Þursaflokkurinn, the Hobgoblins, was formed by Egil Ólafsson, one of the members from Spilverk Þjóðana. Þursaflokkurinn was an original band that mixed together progressive rock influences and old Icelandic folk songs. The result sounded a bit like the Dutch band Focus and the English band Jethro Tull, but with an Icelandic ambient. Þursaflokkurinn was the first Icelandic band to tour extensively abroad. In 1979 they toured Europe for about 4 months and got good reviews for their concerts. The punk and new wave movement had been around abroad for some time, but it was very slow to wash up on Icelandic shores. English punk band The Stranglers played in Reykjavík in 78. 5,000 people went to the concert and saw punk music for the first time. By the end of the 70s, popular Icelandic music had become quite stagnant. The biggest local pop stars were people that had been popular since the 60s. The pop scene was very much in need for a new generation. Then, finally in 1980, this guy came along. His name is Bubi Mortens and he changed everything. His band was called The Outsiders and they played raw rock and roll with lyrics about Icelandic reality, working in a fish factory and stuff like that. Bubi became the new pop star very quickly and there was a remarkable change. All the old pop stars suddenly became not so cool anymore. And lots of new bands came along. Bands such as Fræbladnir, Q4U, Purkur Pillik, Þeir and Tappi Tígaras, with a young Björk Guðmundsdóttir on board. Iceland in 1980 to 82 was a very fertile time for music. This period was well documented in the documentary film Rocky Reykjavík that premiered in 1982. Later this time in the Icelandic rock history has been called the Rocky Reykjavík period. None of the Rocky Reykjavík bands got well known outside of Iceland at the time. But Þeir had their album As Above released on a small UK label and Purkur Pillik went on tour with English band The Fall in England. The first Icelandic international hit came in fact from a totally different direction. The band is called Mezzo Forte and they played instrumental jazz fusion music. Their manager, local record mogul Steinar Berg, had much faith in the band and had been pushing them for some years. Being an Icelander at the time was a big disadvantage because there was no known history of good music coming out of the country. International music business people usually just started to laugh when they were told about this Icelandic band, Mezzo Forte, It was coming from such a ridiculous place. Despite this, Mesoforte's big hit, Garden Party, went all the way to number 17 on the UK singles charts in 1983. This was, of course, a cause for a national celebration. In 1983, the first pop radio station opened in Iceland, Rás 2. Also run by the government, like the first radio station. And Rás 2 mostly played very commercial pop music. Not much was happening on the rock scene, but some people from the old Rocky Reykjavik bands came together to form a new band called Kukl. In Kukl, you had Björk Guðmundsdóttir from Tappi Tíkaras, Einar Örd from Purkupilnik, God Christ and Siggi from Þeir, Birgir Mogensen from Spilafíbl and Einar Melax from Van Houten's Coco. Kukl played very introvert and difficult music. They were not liked at all in Iceland. When they played, maybe 50 people or so came to their concerts. Einar Örd, one of Kukl's singers, was living in London at the time, getting his degree in media studies. Einar had operated a record company, Gram Records, in Iceland since 1981, and through his contacts he knew people all over Europe. Kukl went on many European tours, traveling together in a small van and playing small concerts. In 1986, when Kukl had been around for 3 years and released 2 albums, everybody in the group was very tired. They were tired of touring and they were tired of the seriousness of the music. And they wanted to play simple pop music. Guitarist Thor Eldon was Björk's boyfriend at the time. He had for some time had the idea of making a pop group whose main purpose was to make money. With this money, they could make serious and artistic things with their record label Smekklesa, Bad Taste. Out of this idea came the band The Sugar Cubes, or Sigurmolarnir in Icelandic. And everything worked according to plan, not least thanks to the song Birthday, or Ammali, as it was called when it came out in Iceland in 1986. Kukl had sometimes played with an English band called Flux of Pink Indians, and the bassist from that band, Derek Burkett, was putting together a record label at the time, One Little Indian. It was decided that One Little Indian would release the Sugar Cubes birthday song in the autumn of 87. Soon there was a great buzz surrounding the Sugar Cubes, and the band was all over the UK music media, appearing on the covers of New Musical Express and Melody Maker in the same week. In all the hundreds of interviews that the band did, they were always asked about Iceland, the way Icelanders are, the nature, and so on. The foreign journalists hardly knew anything about Iceland and were very much interested in everything. The sugar cubes, who were almost like a tourist information center on their own, played up to the image of Iceland as being a group of strange people living in a strange place. In the interviews, there was always something about the common local belief in elves, about strange food like puffin, shark or ram testicles, and so on and so forth. The sugar cubes were the first Icelandic band to become famous outside of Iceland, and they were quite popular, played concerts around the world and sold millions of records. The sugar cubes broke up in 1992 after a successful tour with the most popular band in the world at the time, U2. Björk wanted to do her own kind of music, and she was very much influenced by the electronic dance music scene. Her first solo album came out in 1993 and is called Debut. Björk's record label, Still One Little Indian, estimated that the album might perhaps sell 40,000 copies, but instead it became a smash hit. When the year 1993 was over, Debut had sold 1.2 million copies, and Björk's face was all over the international media. Iceland had gotten its first international superstar. For the next years, Björk got only more and more popular and famous. Her second solo album, Post, from 1995, was even more successful than Debut. Björk did thousands of interviews, she was all over the media, and she played all over the world. As Björk got more and more famous, Iceland got more and more hip and cool. Now it was an established fact that good music could come out of this tiny island. Some bands in the 90s tried to get their music heard outside of Iceland, bands such as Bellatrix, Unun and Luk. But most successful of those post-Björk bands was Gus Gus, who got signed to an English record label, 4AD, and for a moment were likely to be the next big thing. Instead, the next big music export was this bunch of hairy guys. Sigur Rós had been going since 1994, but their breakthrough was an album called Ágætis Byrjun, released in 1999. Sigur Rós music, like Björk's music, was artistic and very emotional. It made a strong impression on the listeners. Ágætis Byrjun was an album it was okay to cry to. When foreign journalists wrote about it, they always used descriptions related to Icelandic nature. Something like, this sounds like glaciers melting, or geysers sprouting, or this is as powerful as a waterfall. And sometimes the sound of singer Jóns's vocals was likened to a crying dolphin or a singing whale. Sigur Rós, just like the sugar cubes and Björk before, always had to talk about Iceland in their interviews with the foreign media. Just like before, Sigur Rós became a tourist information center on their own. Sigur Rós used the Icelandic landscape as a backdrop for photo shoots, and they said in interviews that they often went out in the unspoiled Icelandic nature for influences. By the beginning of the 21st century, tiny Iceland had two big international alternative music superstars, Björk and Sigur Rós. The island was now considered hip and cool and appeared regularly in best places to travel lists. The result was a boom in tourism. Iceland had become connected to introverted and artistic music. The groups that became known outside of Iceland after the major breakthrough of Björk and Sigur Rós did keep this way. Artists and bands such as Soley, Emiliana Torrini and Moom all do introverted and artistic things. Our newest internationally famous band is called Of Monsters and Men, and yes, they also use Icelandic nature when they pose for a group photo. They are not as original as Björk or Sigur Rós. They are more mainstream. When you hear them, there is really nothing Icelandic about them. They could as well be from Boston or Atlanta or Birmingham. Of Monsters and Men have released 3 albums which have sold millions, and the band has played all over the world. Of Monsters and Men have to act as a tourist information center as well, and they still get the same, basically the same questions as the Sugar Cubes got when they are interviewed abroad. The newest addition to Iceland's Wall of Fame is composer Hildur Guðnadóttir. She has had an amazing success for her original scores for television miniseries Chernobyl and for her music in Joker, which she got an Oscar award for. Hildur had been playing and singing in local bands since the 90s, bands such as Woofer, Runk and Moom. And prior to making scores, she had released solo albums with atmospheric cello work. She is the first Icelander ever to get an Oscar. Critics across the world always say they can hear the landscape in Icelandic music, be it the crystalline adventures of Björk og Sigurrós, which are generally followed by words like epic, magical and glacial. Foreign people seem to have a certain image in mind when they consider Icelandic music. In Iceland though, nobody is thinking about the image and doing anything special to fulfill those expectations. Everybody is just doing whatever they feel like doing. In Iceland there is a lot of space for everybody, and individualism is a large part of people's character. Also, as can be seen over and over in the past, Icelanders are not afraid of failure. If you fail this time, you can always try again. In fact, the motto that most Icelanders live by is Þetta rettast. A rough translation, it will all work out okay. And yes, usually it does. So that's it. Thank you very much.